Happy Labor Day. I'm working. Well, okay, there's some matter of some dispute. I'm doing this. I'll call it working. And you won't see this on Labor Day, but I'm recording it on Labor Day. And I'm doing it under some duress because the air conditioning system in the upper part of the house where the Ham Radio Now studios are located has been out for past day or so. So it's getting pretty toasty up here. Could be worse. It could be one of those 100-degree days in North Carolina, but it's not. It's been, okay, you know, mid-80s or so. But it's pretty toasty up here. Got fans running all over the place. So here we go. Ham Radio Now, episode 217. HOAs oppose parity. ARRL fights back. I'm Gary Pierce, KM4AQ. And I was at the Shelby Hamfest over the weekend.
Welcome to the Shelby Hamfest, the ARRL Roanoke Division Convention.
It's always on Labor Day weekend. And I had a chance to sit down with ARRL President Kay Craigie and Roanoke Division Director Jim Boehner, Dr. Jim Boehner. And we talked mostly about parity. Yes, so it's another parity episode. Well, let me show you something. The reason why I did another parity talk, besides having the chance to talk to Kay about it, is this thing that appeared a little while ago, a week or so ago, on QRZ.com, HOAs Take Aim at Our Hobby. And it was a post by a fellow who got an email, or whose son got an email. It says here from his homeowners association, but it's actually from an association of associations. And it is their communication to their members about the Parity Act. So we'll talk in depth about that. Let's see. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. I should mention that. Arvin is sitting back there wanting me to have you come to the Ham Radio Now. I don't remember what we are. HamRadioNow.tv website. And click on his icon. His icon is sitting over here. Definitely right there. You'll understand why I'm doing that if you get to the end of the episode. What else have I got to mention here? When I do the interview, I'm going to be using a little microphone like this, a little lavalier microphone. But I'm not going to have it sitting on my shirt because that would have been too far away and it would have been too noisy. So I'm holding it up here like this. Let me see how this sounds. Testing 1, 2. Testing 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You know, Bob Heil, it doesn't sound that much worse than the PR40 here. It's not bad. If you're listening carefully, you can hear that there's a fair amount of more ambient noise. And it's not because of what Bob Heil says, that electret condensers, this is an electret condenser mic, are just way too sensitive. Oh, it's no more sensitive than the dynamic mic, the PR40. It's an omnidirectional mic, so it's picking up noise from all over the place. The PR40 is a directional mic, and so it's rejecting all the fan noise and stuff from behind. They can make electret condensers that are directional. This one just isn't. It's not designed to be that way. So I need to say something briefly before we get started with the episode. I need to say Hurricane Isabel, and I also need to say Hurricane Isabel. And I need to say it like this, Hurricane Isabel, because I'm not sure how I said it in the episode, but when I said it, I didn't say Isabel. I said Irene. So I'm going to pull some, back to the PR40. I'm going to pull some audio magic and fix my blunder. I think that's all I've got to do here. It's hot, so I want to get out of here and get the episode going. Plus, it's kind of long. We had a good long talk. We will talk about the ARRL dues increase, and we'll wrap it up with a little bit of discussion on the structure of the ARRL. Probably a little wonky for most people, but you might be interested, especially since Kay is going to be resigning or letting her term lapse and not running again as president. So they'll be selecting a new president. And no, we will not be voting for the new ARRL president. We vote for, well, we'll explain it. You just have to stick around for the whole episode, and we'll tell you all about it. Yes, that should lock you in for approximately an hour and a half discussion. Let's go to the Shelby Hamfest and Roanoke Division Convention, and let's talk parity or ham radio or something. What are we going to talk about?
Okay, camera synchronization. That's mostly to wake everybody up.
Yeah.
And let's talk ham radio.
Okay, let's do it, Gary.
Sounds like a good idea.
Yes.
Ladies first and presidents first, Kay Craigie, N3K, I need to remember the call sign, ARRL president. Welcome back to Ham Radio Now.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to see you again. Last time we talked, it was at the Dayton Hamvention several years ago.
Yes, and I kept you from your appointed rounds for way longer than I should have. I apologize, but we had a good talk.
We had a good conversation.
Yes, and you probably haven't seen it, but I have a little snippet of what you said in my fundraising pitch on Patreon.
Okay.
So thank you for saying interesting things to get me to get something stuck into the Patreon. And a brand new ARRL division director, Jim Boehner.
That's correct. Jim Boehner and N2ZZ, and yep. Have been division director since January this yep. year.
And for the Roanoke division.
For the Roanoke division.
That one that, and this is your first time on the show. This is the third time I've tried to get you.
Yes, but today I have no plane to catch, so we're in good shape.
And we are at the Shelby Hamfest. I think I said that in the introduction a little while ago. I was stumbling over your name because Boehner's, you must have had a lot of fun as a kid with that one.
Well, I probably heard just about every joke. However, every one of my kids were very proud of the name and seemed to have suffered through childhood very well.
No mental scars.
Mental scars. And I discussed with my wife whether or not I was going to change the pronunciation when I moved down to the South. But said, no, I guess it was just a proud name thing.
Yeah. So, we'll go with it, even though I stumble over it a little bit. You're a medical doctor.
I am. I'm an OBGYN in Aiken, South Carolina.
Okay. I've just got to stop now. All the possible jokes as an OBGYN. So we'll just have to move on to the ham radio stuff. You guys have just recently, anyway, finished up with a board meeting.
That's right.
Interesting. Always?
Oh, they're always interesting. I've been in that room in one capacity or another since January of 1990, and I've never come out of a meeting saying, well, that was boring.
Did you come out and say, what the heck did we just do?
No. I usually have enough of a attention span to know pretty much what it was.
Have known exactly what it was. You may not have expected the outcome.
Well, you never know, because you've got 15 directors with 15 different points of view, and there's spirited discussion, and decisions are made, and then we all move forward.
Well, I'd like to talk about that, but I'd like to talk about that a little bit later if we have time and they haven't kicked us out of the Hamfest or tried to make this as late in the day for things to get quiet. And the ARRL booth here has stayed busy well past all the commercial booths, so that's a testament to what's going on at the league these days. There are several things that I'd like to talk to you guys about, but I think the number one most important thing going on in ham radio right now, and you wouldn't know it from listening or to any of the other ham radio shows, because they're not talking about this, but I talk about it a lot, is the Amateur Radio Parity Act. And things have been happening with that. Where do we stand?
Well, where we stand is that as of this moment, HR 1301, which is the bill in the House, has 94 co-sponsors. We are expecting to pick up a few more who gave us commitments during the August recess. So that's moving right along. We always need more co-sponsors. So if people can contact their members of Congress, write them a letter, send it to care of ARRL headquarters so that it doesn't get held up for security screening, and we'll get it hand-delivered. Send them an email via their congressional website. Call up a local office and say, please become a co-sponsor of HR 1301. So that's moving right ahead with Congressman Greg Walden as our mentor, and Mr. Kinzinger who introduced the legislation for us, and Mr. Courtney, who is the co-sponsor. So on the House side, we are doing really well. I would love to see us go into the triple digits very soon with the co-sponsors. On the Senate side, Senator Wicker of Mississippi came to us and said, I want to introduce this legislation in the United States Senate.
And do you know how that happened?
We do. There is a radio amateur whose name, unfortunately, I do not have at the tip of my tongue, who has had a good working relationship with the senator's office for some time. And he explained to the senator's staff why this is important legislation for amateur radio and for the United States, really, as well as for, of course, the state of Mississippi, which understands about emergencies and emergency communications because of Katrina.
Yeah. 10-year anniversary has just passed.
Yes, exactly. And as a matter of fact, Senator Wicker got on the air at one of the Katrina special stations.
Oh, cool.
And is a very strong supporter of amateur radio. So his office, actually I got an email from this radio amateur in Mississippi who's got a good relationship with the senator's office. He said, call this young lady who's a staffer in Senator Wicker's office. I called her. Within a matter of, I think a week or 10 days, the senator had introduced the legislation. With a co-sponsor from the Democratic side of the aisle, from Senator Blumenthal. But Senator Wicker came to us because, as his office put it, it's good public policy.
But also because a ham
had over the years developed a good relationship with the senator's office, and we've had a number of co-sponsors on the House side who have come in because radio amateurs have a good relationship with their member of Congress. Sometimes it's because those of us who walk the halls on Capitol Hill have been able to make a good pitch and back it up with letters and communications from constituents, and so the congressmen and women have signed up. But there's still a very important role for the individual American citizen radio amateur to be a strong advocate for amateur radio in this way. So, you know, I've described it as a full team effort, and with a lot of help from thousands of radio amateurs around the country, we're making progress on this extremely important legislative goal. So I want to thank everybody who may be watching your program who has written to their congressmen, to their senators. Thank you for doing that. If they sign on to the bill, please communicate to them and say thank you for doing that, because good manners is good strategy. And if they haven't signed on yet, keep communicating with them until they do.
We've just been through the month of August, a recess in Congress, when everybody went home and met with constituents. And this is a particularly good year for that, for constituents' pressing points, because all of the energy in terms of getting reelected is on the president's right now. We're in an off year. There's no congressional elections. There's no Senate elections, I don't think, coming up this year. So everybody's kind of, you know, taking a breather from campaigning, which means they can actually talk to constituents about things. Have you heard any stories, either here at the HamFest or anytime, about hams who went to talk to their legislators?
I have not, but I would certainly welcome hearing from those folks how those conversations went and what issues may have been on their political officials' minds, so they can address those if we need to. So if anybody watching us now would like to let us know, we'd be more than interested in hearing, you know, how did it go? Did it go well? Did it go poorly? You know, what's on these folks' minds?
And it's not too late. They're back in Washington, but they've got their staff here. Jim, you've had some experience, I think, talking with congressional staff.
I haven't had the experience. A few of the other directors and the rest have had specific, but I have not actually visited my congressman yet. He is, actually, my congressman is Joe Wilson, and that name should trigger a couple of memories from the past. But I hope to be able to get in with him and bring a group, the Keelan group, who now works with us in terms of political matters, and The name now escapes me right now. They have given us a briefing on how to be able to approach the elected officials. And for those people that may be listening on your show, it's important that you may not speak specifically with the senator or the representative, but you might speak with their staff. But that is okay. and that's
It's more than okay. It's probably the only thing you're going to get to do, and these are the people that actually get things done.
Well, yep. It is. The staff people, you know, no member of Congress and no senator can be perfectly well-informed on every issue in the world. So the staffers, when I go into a congressman's office, I usually talk with a staffer and give them the information. I discuss, if possible, I discuss what kinds of disasters might affect that congressional district and try to tailor my presentation to that. But I talk to the staffer because they're the ones who are going to give the advice to the member of Congress. And if they say, yeah, this looks like a good thing for our district, especially if I can hand them a stack of letters, or in some cases they say, yeah, we've been getting phone calls about that, they do notice. They keep records. They pay attention.
I did a show with Chris Imlay and Hudson Division Director.
Mike Lysenko.
Sorry, mm-hmm. Mike. And they told me some of the anecdotes about plying the halls of Congress, and you've had plenty of opportunity to do that too. Tell me a little bit about it.
Yes, Mike's been tremendously active as an advocate for this legislation and done really outstanding work. And a number of other ARRL directors and some of the staff members have done it as well. It's not like fifth grade civics. I've learned a lot more about how a bill becomes law than I ever learned back in the fifth grade at the W.D. Thompson Elementary School in Decatur, Georgia.
Can we all sing the song? I'm just a bill on Capitol Hill. Yes.
Yeah, it doesn't work that way. But certainly some very, very interesting folks. My favorite story about advocacy for this legislation, though, doesn't involve one of us who represents the organization nationally. I used to be the Atlantic Division Director, which includes the state of Delaware, which is a very small population, very small amateur radio population, small ARRL membership. They were having some difficulty getting their one congressman to sign on to H.R. 1301. And they tried this and they tried that. And what finally worked was that they got 50% of the amateur radio population in the state of Delaware to sign letters to their congressman. So when an ARRL representative walked into that congressman's office, handed them a stack of letters for 50% of the radio amateurs in Delaware, the next day that congressman signed on. So there was a congressman who was listening and who saw that the constituents were really in favor of this. And it's a great story because here's little Delaware that brought in their congressman because an awful lot of radio amateurs decided that they wanted this to happen.
And that reinforces what Chris and Mike were telling me, was their entree to a congressional office was a handful of letters from constituents in that state, or maybe preferably the district, but at least the state, saying, here are your people, and here's what they want us to come in here and talk to you about. And that got them more welcomed into these offices than just showing up saying, I've got something I want you to support.
Oh, yes, and that's it was mentioned at the forum this morning, the ARRL forum this morning, that I recognized the name of one of the staffers who had been called on, because I called on him. And I made the pitch, and he was very polite and very receptive and very cordial, and we didn't get the co-sponsorship. There was a return visit that involved a stack of constituent letters. And the next day, the congressman signed on. So it wasn't that they were against the legislation. They just weren't for it enough because they weren't getting that constituent support. It's interesting legislation to advocate for because it's not a Democratic issue versus a Republican issue. It's not a liberal issue versus a conservative issue. It's a common sense and basic fairness. And you can sell that concept on all sorts of political philosophies, much as we might cynically say it doesn't. But it actually does. We have co-sponsors for H.R. 1301 who are so politically far apart from one another that they would probably argue about the time of day. But they come together to support this legislation because they see that it's a matter of simple fairness.
Yeah, Chris made the case pretty well about how it is non-controversial, but there are still, there is opposition, and we'll talk about that in just a minute. But I want to talk more about the letters, because Jim, you've been here at this HamFest and a bunch of HamFests talking to hams and encouraging them to sign letters, and they've been doing that all day here at the Shelby HamFest. What's your experience with those hams? Do they understand the issue? What do they take persuading?
As a matter of fact, we just saw someone at the booth today that had just said, look, if you don't want to be bothered by the homeowner's covenants, then just don't go into a homeowner covenant place. And there were so many things wrong with that statement that you couldn't say it in one sentence. One of the things is that many of the people, well, for example, from numbers, I think in 1970, 2 million people were affected by CCNRs. As of, I think, 2010, there were 72 million, and it's just going up and going up. The numbers are staggering to the point where you can't even buy a home now without having some covenants that are placed on it. And the other argument I hear is, well, I don't want to go against private contracts. Well, the private contract issue has not been present for a number of years. Basically, the only choice a homeowner would have is whether or not to live in this particular community or not. And many people will choose their homes based on the schools, based on their jobs and the rest. And amateur radio is at least at that time, not the most primary driving issue. But the opposition that we have also brings up some interesting statements. I think one of their statements is that hams don't have to operate from their homes. They just find an emergency, they take all their portable equipment and go there. Nothing could be further than from the truth. You have a community that's isolated because of some form of a disaster, and there's no way of getting the word out. People who may need medicine, people who are cut off from the normal infrastructure, they have no way to communicate. And one thing that seems to be clear amongst all radio amateurs is that we all have the ability to communicate, whether or not you're in amateur radio emergency services, if you're a DX or if you're a contest or whatever. If you're in that community and you have ability to get the word out, you do have that ability and be able to get to a non-disaster area to be able to get help, get word, get health and welfare out. So as far as the letters go, that, as Kay says, has been the most powerful thing for the people that have been up on Capitol Hill, because there's nothing like getting a bunch of letters from people who will eventually vote for a political candidate that will get their attention stronger. And I do think they have a good basic understanding of what's going on with the letters. We do explain it to them. When I was doing my forum today, I said, is there anybody that hasn't heard of H.R. 1301 or the fact that the Senate is on? And it's hard to think, but there are some hams that do not know. But we do take the time to explain it to them before they just blindly sign a letter. To answer your question, there's a lot of understanding that is going out amongst hams. And they also understand that it may not affect them right away. They may have a huge antenna system and it doesn't matter to them. But it may. I mean, if they end up living in an assisted living home or something like that later on in life, their chance of operating anything other than repeaters and ham radio is gone.
And plus, we have about, 30,000 hams every year who get a license for the first time, and they live in a house.
Sure.
They didn't know anything about ham radio.
When my husband and I got licensed in the early 1980s, we already owned a home. We didn't have the good fortune to become radio amateurs as kids. We were in our 30s when we got our licenses, so we already owned a home. Fortunately, it came under municipal zoning, and fortunately, we were able to have a modest antenna, and I had a lot of fun. I got DXCC. We did traffic handling. We did all that good stuff. But if we had lived in a different community, that probably would have ruled out amateur radio for us. And so emergency communications is important. How do you become an effective emergency communicator? You don't pull that out of your ear the day that the hurricane is bearing down on you. You learn your craft, and you learn your craft by operating day in and day out from your home station. So being able to operate from your home station is how you learn to be useful for that unfortunate day when something bad happens. So that's point number one. But point number two.
Let me keep on point number one for just a, sure. just a little
Go
longer
ahead.
Because
right.
that is the two arguments that I hear. One from, both from homeowners associations. They say, first of all, if you need to put up an antenna in an emergency, of course you can. Doesn't do you any good, because if you don't have the practice, if you don't have the skill and the antenna, you're not going to be able to put it up. And if you've had no ability to use it for 4 years, why would you even bother? Why, you wouldn't be interested
yes.
anymore. So you're not going to have that antenna and that knowledge that you're talking about to
yes.
to put it up when the emergency happens and, okay, now help us, please. And then the take your portable equipment, like Jim was saying, take your portable equipment into the emergency, because that's where you really need it. You don't need it at home. Well, why would you have portable equipment to take to an emergency if you can't use it every
exactly.
day? So I think we need to really pound
yes.
that
and
concept.
When I make the pitch in the congressional offices, I talk about learning your craft. It takes practice, whether you're playing the piano or being a radio amateur. You have to learn your craft, and we do that by operating day in and day out from our homes so that we learn the art and the science of radio.
Yeah.
And there absolutely is no substitute for it.
As practiced, as coordinated, and as not regimented, that's not the word I'm looking for, but as organized as our emergency communications is, it's like that fog of war thing. As soon as the crap hits the fan, almost all the practice and experience comes into play in figuring out how to do it now, because all the rules have been broken. So you need, this isn't easy stuff to do. If it was easy, anybody could do it. So we need to be able to play with our stuff. There's a message here, not just for Congress and not for homeowners associations. There's a message for hams. Hams need to learn their craft better too. They need to really dig in and figure this stuff out. Because I've been on public service events when a ham needed to put a new frequency in their radio and they couldn't do it. Or something didn't work. A repeater went down and we all needed to change. And too many hams weren't able to do that. So we have a responsibility too to learn our craft better. And there's, when people say, well, I don't know why people bother with contests. I don't like that contest stuff. Contesting teaches you how to do things really, really hard and, you know, blood and guts. And whether you're going to try to win the contest or not, to get in there and participate in it effectively, even if it's just for a couple of hours, is going to teach you something that you're not going to learn just rag show.
Well, I couldn't agree more. I am a contester. I have been a member of the Frankfurt Radio Club and recently became a member of the Potomac Valley Radio Club. So I'm a great believer in the value of contesting to teach you to have good ears so that you can dig signals out of bedlam, so that you learn about propagation, so that you figure out how to engineer your station better, so that you just develop the endurance to keep your backside in the chair for hours and hours and hours. There's a great deal you can learn to make you a proficient operator through doing contesting. And there are other ways to do that. I just happen to like to do it through contesting, and it has made me a better operator.
All around. And a better emergency communicator when that happens to.
Fortunately, I've never had to do that, but I'm interested in developing my skills more and being a more proficient radio amateur. And I think that whatever a person really loves to do on the air, do it and have fun with it and realize that the hidden benefit, if you will, is that you're improving your skills and your competency against that day that we hope will never come, when something bad happens in your community or elsewhere, so that you can actually be a proficient amateur, so that you can improvise. You've got to know how to improvise, and that doesn't sound like it makes sense on the surface, but it actually does. You've got to know a good bit before you can figure out how to improvise effectively, and that's a tremendous asset that we bring to the table in emergency communications, is that when it looks like it's impossible, we say, okay, it'll take me 15 minutes, and then you go and you do it.
Yeah. I've got a quick story from my own experience that illustrates what you're talking about. Hurricane Isabel was about, I don't know, 10 years ago in North Carolina. It was before, more than 10 years ago, because it was before Katrina. It hit eastern North Carolina. I live east, but not deep east North Carolina. And one of the rural counties lost all of their public safety communications. Police department, fire department, EMS, everybody was on one tower. And that tower got knocked over by the hurricane. And so ham radio got called in. The primary goal for us was to set up at fire departments. We set up stations at fire departments and through a ham repeater in a neighboring county that was still working. And we provided that communications. My assignment was to go to the 911 center. And the 911 center was built in what had been a bank branch. So it was built like a brick house and had no RF. Everything in their beautiful, probably federally paid for console went by wireline to radios at the base of the tower that was in a crumpled heap on the ground. And so I got there and introduced myself to the dispatcher, who had nothing to dispatch. The phone systems were working well enough in town that people could call the police, sort of. Well, they could reach 911 and the 911 center, sort of. Not from every place, but sort of. And he had a handy talkie on simplex that he could reach a police car a mile and a half away. And that was it. That's as far as he could go. And maybe that one police officer could then relay to another one and get around the county a little bit. What I was able to do instantly was put my mobile radio in the parking lot in crossband repeat. Now, fortunately, I'd done something that a lot of hams will say is a bad idea, but I had pulled that diode out of my radio so it would transmit in the public safety part of the band. And so I set up a crossband repeater from a 50-watt radio in a car instead of a 1-watt handy-talkie inside a bank branch that allowed the dispatcher to now talk to the police cars in about a 10-mile radius instead of a 1-mile radius. Step one. Step two, as I busted a hole in the side of the bank branch, ran some coax, they did have one little bit of RF. They had a satellite antenna on a mast, ran a piece of coax out, after I got them set up for the crossband repeat, ran a piece of coax out the hole that I had to punch in the side of the building, and put a magnet mount up on top of that mast, and now I gave them a radio that could talk at least halfway around the county. They couldn't reach the farthest reaches of the county, but they could talk halfway around it. That was pretty much independent of the rest of the ham radio activity. I'm not an engineer, I'm a ham. I learned all that stuff, how to do all that stuff, by being a ham and like hamming like crazy. And if I couldn't do that at home, I'd have never learned how to do that.
Sure, because the first thing, first of all, is to be a radio amateur. Whatever that means to a person, be a radio amateur. And then you're ready to take the next step to be a proficient emergency communicator. But first of all, be a radio amateur. Now, I said that there was another reason why we want this legislation.
Yeah, number two.
Can I say one thing?
Sure, go ahead.
One before we go off that topic. There was a perfect analogy that came to me about not being able to have radio stations at your home. It's almost like having someone come up to an orchestra and be able to play a concerto without even practicing. Or perhaps
exactly.
To not even have learned their instruments in the first place.
Not even have an instrument.
That was probably one of the best analogies I had ever heard about that. Yeah. I wanted to share that.
Yeah.
So
I heard a cool thing about the word analogy on a show recently. The plural of analogy is data.
I'll have to think about that.
Well, we think, well, it's just a... my story was just one story.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Yes.
But my story gets repeated by hams across the country every year.
Yeah.
In maybe not thousands of cases, but tens or dozens of cases. And so, yeah, I have one little story to tell. The plural of that is not analogy. It's not a bunch of analogies. It comes together as data.
So we're all interested in getting young people into amateur radio.
No, we're not. We
and
don't want any.
Everybody,
get off the lawn, damn kids.
Everybody says we need to have younger people. And, of course, from where I sit, anybody under 50 is getting to be something of a youngster. But we know what we're talking about when we talk about youngsters amateur radio. A lot of people who are hams today got started as young folks, and it led them into careers. It led them into all kinds of interesting opportunities in their lives. So what if little Johnny and Mary Jane come home and say, hi, I just learned about amateur radio and scouts at school, whatever, and I want to be a radio amateur. And mom and dad have bought a house in a development that doesn't allow antennas. You're done.
Yeah.
So in order to offer young people the blessing of being radio amateurs, we need to make sure that whatever community their parents decide to buy a house in, that they will be able to have some kind of a functioning antenna so they can get on the air and explore it and find out if this is something that's going to be a lifelong interest for them. But we have to make sure that people, whether they're adults like me who got into amateur radio in my 30s, or even more importantly, young people, that they have the opportunity to have reasonable accommodation, to have antennas, because otherwise our future has got a major crimp in it. So making sure that that people who are not even hams yet, maybe even haven't even heard of amateur radio yet, will have that opportunity when they hear about amateur radio, they want to get involved, that they'll be able to do it because they'll be able to have a functioning amateur radio antenna at their home. So part of it is emergency preparedness. Part of it is making sure that American young people will have the opportunity that an awful lot of older hams did, to become hams as young folks and to explore where that's going to take them in their lives.
My story exactly, 15 years old, got my license to a class in high school. 1965, homeowners associations was a concept, still probably a fairy tale dream in some bureaucrats' wildest imagination. Oh, let's organize everybody in our household. Now, there were probably a few out there someplace, but they hadn't hit where I was. So my brother and I scrambled around the roof of our house and stuck up this antenna and took it down, stuck up another antenna and took it down, dipoles, 2-meter beams. Nobody said boo. Neighbors didn't care. Our parents went, what? But they didn't say no, so we just did it. Today, totally different story. There's courtesy of a ham on QRZ had a relative who was in a homeowners association that got a letter from one of their associations, an association of associations, one of the leadership positions in homeowners associations. And I was wondering where the opposition was going to come from, and figuring that that's where it was going to come from. And I looked up their websites and saw a few with some half-hearted, well, this is out there, we need to be careful of it. But this letter was more specific, very, very pointed, and full of either half-truths or untruths. And let me see if I can pull out a couple of them. If the legislation passes and it's moving forward in a way that is threatening.
I love to hear it.
That yes, is great
yes,
news.
Thank you very much for that. It is moving forward in a way that is threatening. Community associations would not be able to require prior approval for 70-foot ham radio towers and antennas, nor would community associations have the ability to reasonably process aesthetic guidelines. In other words, similar types of restrictions on regulation of satellite dishes and certain types of aerial antennas by associations would apply to ham radio if these bills were approved. We need Chris Imlay here, don't we?
No, you don't, because I can say the word false just as quickly as he can. The legislation does not say that. As bills go, it's pretty short and it's in plain English. The legislation does not say that. It does not mean that. And if you can get from what the legislation says and what it means in plain English to what you just read, I don't know how you do that. It's just not true.
So what's what we call FUD?
Well, I call it lots of things, but I don't want to say
well,
that right here.
Fear, uncertainty, and doubt.
Yes.
Yes. Baloney is another word. In light of this untruth that's been making the rounds, we have, within the last week, posted on the ARRL website a new link under the Amateur Radio Parity Act section. And its headline is Clarity on Parity. And it says in about a page and a half what the legislation is intended to do. And it addresses some of these statements that just have no resemblance to anything that is factual in this or any other solar system. So I would encourage people who have heard that stuff to go and take a look at this very short document called Clarity on Parity. And if you know some people who are not so sure after they see those things that are circulating, show them this document. Here's the truth. See, one of the advantages that we have in promoting this legislation is that we're telling them the truth. And that just makes life so much simpler when you're telling people the truth.
I have my own personal deal on the concept of people saying, I'm telling you the truth. Mm-hmm. As soon as I hear somebody say that, I get
the red flags go up. Yeah.
So I worry
but
about
really
that.
But we really are.
Here's the point.
Yes.
Here's a point to consider. Please go look at the alternative.
Yes.
But here's a point I want you to understand from our point of view. The next paragraph in there is the one that we were referring to about we can take our equipment into the disaster. Ham radio enthusiasts indicate this legislation is needed, so they respond to assist in communications during disasters. The truth is, ham radio enthusiasts who aid in the public interest often do so at the site of the local disaster with portable equipment. They're not required to have permanent equipment, such as towers and antennas, at their residence in order to assist in communicating during a disaster, especially when such towers and antennas may pose a health and safety risk to their neighbors during the same disasters. So they got a couple of points in there. We've already said we're not likely to have the equipment to go into a disaster if we don't get a chance to have it at home and practice with it. And the fear is, well, we're putting up towers, they're going to be a danger in a disaster. Really?
There's no documentation of that. There's absolutely no documentation of that. You know, anybody can say anything about anything and try to scare people. But the fact is that no radio amateur is going to put up something that would be first and foremost a danger to his or her own home and their own family. That would be nuts. So we do follow. No, but we're good nuts, okay? You got to make that decision. You know, we're not going to do self-destructive things that would put our families and our own homes at risk. So by proper engineering, we minimize the likelihood that there's going to be any possibility of that. That's not even grabbing at straws.
The other thing I'm thinking of here is that all anyone with an image of what we want to do is 70-foot towers and monster aluminum antennas. Almost every one of us would love to have something like that. Very few of us do, and ever will. There are some. They're not hard to find in any community if you look far enough. But if you look for what most of the hams have who are able to put up antennas, they're wire antennas, they're simple antennas, they're hidden by landscaping, they're behind trees, they are behind the house, they're wherever we can put them that they don't show up that much. And yes, there are a few that stand tall and proud and can be seen from every place in the neighborhood. A few.
And well, those are the ones that seem to end up on all of the websites of our opposition.
Oh, of course.
And of course, the last one I saw was an Earth Moon Earth Array, and it was huge. It was absolutely huge. And I would think any homeowner from one of those areas would be really worried. And if they didn't look into the facts and the fact that there's a lot of half-truths and untruths are being said, they might just say, okay, well, I better write my congressman. And that's probably where they're getting those letters. But the legislation that's proposed does not even come close to saying what they're saying. And Kay, of course, has been right in the middle of all this. But as I'm sitting around and seeing all this stuff going on, I just can't imagine how they can even make the claims that they're making, except it's to people that are not checking the facts.
Chris Imlay put it in three succinct points right out of ERB1. And I tried to memorize those three points. Can't be prohibited.
Right.
Must be reasonably accommodated with the minimum practicable. Well, in ERB1 legislation,
yes. Mm-hmm.
In homeowners associations, it's restrictions. So you can't say no. And if we're telling homeowners associations anything that limits their ability, It's that you can't just say no.
Yes, and that's the only authority that they would lose, is the authority to say, no, go away. Beyond that, it's people coming together like grown-ups and sitting down and negotiating something that will work for the radio amateur. And, you know, the laws of physics are what they are, but something that will work for the radio amateur that will not do gross violence to the nature of the community. So reasonable accommodation is going to mean one thing if you have 3 or 5 acre zoning, maybe. It's going to mean something else if you have a smaller lot size. Something else if you have like a townhouse development or a condominium building. But people will be able to come together. The amateur radio operator will make his or her case. They will talk back and forth and have dialogue and come to an understanding. And that's just, you know, what's unreasonable about reasonable accommodation?
Yep.
And that's, you know, that's what we're looking for. So, you know, if you can negotiate your way to a 70-foot tower and a great big Yagi, hey, go for it. But on
and
the
then
other
sell
hand,
your house to me after you're ready to move out.
Yeah. But if that's not in the cards, then you negotiate something that will allow you to practice your craft and still will not do violence to the nature of the neighborhood.
So
and reasonable people can do that.
That leads to the next paragraph. Again, this is a letter from the president of a homeowners association to their constituents. The vast majority of community associations allow ham radio operators to pursue their hobby if they follow community guidelines. This legislation, quite simply, is about taking that power to regulate their own associations away from the owners of the community and placing that power with the federal
government. Well, that's just not so. I would love to see the list of homeowner associations that do permit amateur radio antennas. Some of them can't under the terms of their restrictions. It says no antennas. It means no antennas. Okay, so I'd love to see that list. Sometimes it says, well, you would have to go before the architectural committee or something along that nature, who are going to take one look at what you want to do and say, well, yeah, you can have an antenna if it's 1 foot off the ground and or something that absolutely won't work because of the laws of physics are what they are. Or they look at what you want and they say no. So it's that argument simply won't hold water. And furthermore, it does not take their authority to regulate away. It only takes away their authority to say no. There's a big difference.
Not in this letter, but something that I've seen. They have something that they want you to send to your congresspeople. The way we're coming up with language that we like hams to send. And one of the things that I recall it saying was that the FCC would then step in and regulate what homeowners associations can do. Chris Imlay specifically said the FCC's got no interest in doing any of this.
No, the FCC is absolutely not going to do that.
They don't have the staff.
They absolutely don't. They've got other fish to fry, apparently. But the FCC is not going to march in, and or no other big, heavy-fisted federal government agency is going to come in to the homeowners association in the middle of your state somewhere and say, you've got to do this. They're not going to do that. It's going to be up to the homeowners association and the radio amateur sitting down and talking with each other and developing something. The only thing that the FCC is going to do, if we are able to accomplish what we absolutely need to accomplish, and that is that they will apply the reasonability principle of PRB1 on a level playing field to people who live under private land use regulation. For 30 years, we've had that under municipal zoning, and as far as I have noticed, the world hasn't come to an end. And a lot of radio amateurs have functioning antennas who would not have been able to have that if it hadn't been for PRB1. So, you know, the world will not come to an end if HOAs actually have to sit down and communicate with the radio amateurs who live there.
Looked like you were going to say something.
Well, not much. As I'm hearing about this, there are little bits and pieces, and of course you hear reasons why people are against the legislation. One of the major things was we don't want to take away the ability to be able to deal with private contracts and put that in the hands of the federal government. And it's kind of an interesting concept because, as Chris Imlay had told us in one of his webinars, is that say that an individual ends up wanting to get a loan to be able to develop a certain land. In order for them to get that loan, they have to assure the bank of certain things, and many a times that comes as burdens to the land or covenants that they must impose. So the builder has these covenants, and once they get finished, they move out of the area, then a homeowners association comes in and says, okay, well, we'll take it from here. And the homeowners associations, let's just say it goes into one of the situations where they say, okay, well, we're going to allow you to have an antenna. Well, if those burdens are on the land, there's the potential that another landowner in that same area can bring suit against the person who gets the antenna regardless of what the homeowners association says. And when that happens, that if that person loses, which he probably will, he'll be liable for both attorney's fees. So this is why the federal government intervention is absolutely mandatory for this reasonable accommodation to occur.
Yeah.
And that was a bright light when Chris had said that, and it hit home. My own situation, I'm very lucky because I moved into an area that ended up having historic covenants about 10 years into my coming into the area, but my antenna was grandfathered. And as far as being in a structure that could be dangerous, all I can tell you is my house will fall over before that antenna does. That is one tough installation.
Yeah, and you're hurricane territory.
Well, actually, I'm happy to say that where I live in South Carolina, all of the evacuation signs point to my house.
So you're in a good spot.
Yes.
You're not right on the coast.
No, but, no. Yeah. I'm actually inland. I'm near Augusta, Georgia.
But hurricanes have...
They certainly can come in
on
that
through.
Way.
In fact, people think they come off of the Carolina coast. They come from the Gulf Coast when they come through that part of the territory. And they can still be pretty devastating as they come
exactly.
through. Exactly. So we talked for a long time about this, and I think, I guess the last thing is on the subject specifically is what should anybody watching this show who hasn't already done something about it do today?
What they should do today is to go to the ARRL website and click on the link to the Amateur Radio Parity Act, find out about it, get informed. And the first and easiest thing to do is to use, there's a sample letter there that you can download for your senator, for your senators, for your representative. Download those, customize them as you see fit, and send them to ARRL headquarters because we will make sure that they get hand carried to those offices on the Hill. So that's one thing you can do. You can also go to your senator and congressman's websites. They have places there where you can send an email. Do that. Send them an email. Please co-sponsor HR 1301. Please co-sponsor S1685. You can also, once you're on that official website, you can find local office telephone numbers. Call them up on the phone. Say the same thing. So I'm a belt and suspenders kind of girl. So I'd like to see people writing letters. I'd like to see them making phone calls, sending emails. If you have ever made the acquaintance of your senator or your member of Congress or a member of their staff, reach out to them. But first of all, of course, get informed, know what you're talking about, and then go forward. And they actually do listen. They actually do keep account. So that's the first thing to do, and to encourage your fellow hams in your clubs, on your nets, on your Twitter feeds, whatever it is that you do. To go and do the same thing.
All right. So that's what the league is doing for us. And now, what the league is doing to us. Raising our dues.
Well, they won't give me a license to print money. And I'm not going to, I love amateur radio, but I'm not going to Leavenworth for you.
Yeah. It's been a long time since there was a dues.
It's been 15 years. Which is a long time.
Yeah. Inflation has been generally low across that period of time.
Yeah, but if you...
But it's still a percent a year, so...
Well, you don't have to take my word for it. Go online, find an inflation calculator. Plug in, I believe it was in 2001 was the last time there was a dues increase. Plug in $39 in that year, and ask what that is in 2015 dollars, and it's more than 49. I'll tell you that right now. So the dues increase takes a big chunk out of the inflationary difference that's taken place since the last dues increase. It doesn't quite get us back to the purchasing power of $39 15 years ago. So, you know, we were doing really well with voluntary donations, and we appreciate everybody who's made donations over.
Yeah, Mary Hobart's done a pretty good
Mary
job.
Mary Hobart's a force of nature. We miss her very much, yeah. But we deeply appreciate everything she did for us. But one of the things that it did was we all felt really good that, gosh, we're bringing in this money because of the kindness and generosity of radio amateurs. So we don't need to raise the dues.
I tossed out a name that we didn't explain. Yeah. Mary Hobart was what was
she
her
was
official
the
title?
Chief Development Officer for ARRL yeah. for most of that 15-year period, and she did a fabulous mm-hmm. job. And we're all very grateful to her and to the people that she reached out to who responded. So, you know, we were no director. I was a director. No director likes to vote for a dues increase. No member likes to have a dues increase. But looking back on it, we should have had smaller dues increases over that 15-year period so that we wouldn't have had to have a $10 dues increase all in one great chunk.
Yeah, that was going to be my next question, whether yes. that was subject to big debate at the director's
meeting. Oh, it has
meeting.
Been talked about very much. And our Administration and Finance Committee, which is the committee of the ARRL Board of Directors that has oversight of policy recommendations about the management and the finances of the league. At the last meeting, I sit in on those meetings, although I'm not a working member of the committee. But we realized that there should have been smaller incremental dues increases in that 15-year period in order to pretty much keep pace with inflation, so at least we weren't losing ground. And so the committee decided that going forward, we're going to take a look every year at where looking at standard consumer price indexes, you know, objective sources of information about inflation, to see how that matches up against the existing dues. We're certainly not going to have a dues increase every year. But to keep looking at those annually so that when you get to a certain discomfort level, if you will, between the existing dues rate and the purchasing power of that money, so that then it may be time to think again about a dues increase so that at least we don't lose ground. Yeah. We're doing many more programs, many more services, and we need to continue doing those things. And dues has a part to play in that.
The concept of a dues increase did not come up for the first time in 15 years at this board meeting. It's been brought up periodically. Maybe not every year, but it's been brought up several times. And the decision must have been yeah. no.
And the reason was because the voluntary donations were so successful. And, you know, again, hindsight's 20/20. And looking back at it, we realized that we should have inched the dues up a little bit here and there over time
to
minimize the sticker shock. And we're trying to make sure that we don't have to do this again by doing that annual comparison and saying, okay, what is it that we don't want to cut programs, we don't want to cut services, because we've got an important mission for amateur
And you know
radio.
You're going to lose some members to
We
it.
Certainly will. We will lose some members, some of whom will eventually come back and some of whom, unfortunately, will not. That always happens when there's a dues increase, and we can plot that historically. It's one of the things we did in thinking about should there be a dues increase, and if so, how much. We looked at historical data about dues increases in the past. We looked at the graphs. We looked at all kinds of facts and figures. So we know that there will be a dip in membership, and that's unfortunate because we would like all licensees to be league members, and we certainly don't want to lose any members. But on the other hand, we've also got to be financially responsible. And since we don't want to cut programs and services, then we have to make sure that we take some difficult financial steps to make sure that we can pay the bill to do for amateur radio what we need to do.
Membership is currently how big? 170?
I think it's in the 170,000s.
Yeah. Is that an all-time high, or has there been a period in the past where...
I think it is an all-time high, Gary. It's certainly... It's certainly an encouraging number.
That's with the number of total licensed hams at 700,000, mm-hmm. that is far too small a percentage considering what the league does. And you know, like everybody, there are things the league does that I don't like. There are things the league does that you don't like. But the best investment I ever made in 1974 was $180 in a life membership, and I've never thought about sending that back.
Good. I'm glad to hear that. We certainly appreciate the folks who have shown confidence in the organization by becoming life members. But the folks who pay their dues year by year by year are, you know, that's the great majority of ARRL members.
I hope you invested my money well.
We do, as a matter of fact, and our auditors make sure that we do. And our audited financial statements are out there for anybody to take a look at.
Yep.
But, you know, it's in order to be financially responsible, sometimes you have to make difficult decisions. And believe me, the decision to raise the dues was not done lightly. It was not done in a snap of the fingers. It was done after considerable research and thinking and consideration of other options. And the discussion within the board meeting was very thoughtful, and it's you know, that's just not a decision that anyone makes lightly, and we understand that it's difficult for
was
folks.
Was it a unanimous decision?
It was not.
Was it close?
It was close. But it was not unanimous.
And if I could just mention one thing, Gary, I am on the ANF committee, and because I'm on the ANF committee, I was a member that was looking at all these numbers. I'm not a financial wizard by any means, but when I saw the numbers, I saw this was absolutely necessary, and there really was no other way about it. We looked at a $6 dues increase versus a $10. The $6 one would have brought us back to the members in a few years asking for another pay hike, and that just didn't seem reasonable. It seemed that we really, that the $10 figure was actually a conservative one, and I think it was made properly, and I think it was considered by the board properly. I also thank them for doing this during my election year.
So you're up for re-election.
Well, fortunately, the everything has come up for I believe five divisions, and I was both Bill Marine and I ran unopposed, so we have been declared winners for the next three-year term starting in January 2016.
Okay, so you don't have to worry about this.
No, but I, one of the things that's really important, the amazing thing, you would think I've got, would have got a sea of emails, you would think that I'd have a bunch of people threatening to quit. I have not heard one. And I think everybody knew. As a matter of fact, I had people come up to me and says, the league's got to raise dues. And I was just very, very surprised about this. I've not heard one complaint, and this was a very appropriate decision for the health of the league and for all that the ARRL can do for not only its members, but we're doing all this for non-members too. They are benefiting from those people that are paying for membership by spectrum defense and a number of other issues that we're always on top of. So, and when I say we're, I mean the league. We are on top of things. Something happens to our 5 gigahertz allocation, on it like a dog on a pork chop. Yep. As Southerners say. So everybody benefits from what the league does, and we thank all the members for being members and the fact that they realize, at least from what I've heard and not heard in this division, that the dues increase was necessary.
And if you're mad about it, be mad about it for a while, mm-hmm. and then send in your dues. And if you want to not ever have to worry about this again, become a life member.
And the interesting thing that's happened over the years is over these last 15 years, we've added services. So someone asked, well, what are you going to do with the extra $10? And I said, look, we have been increasing services for the last 15 years. We now have a digital version of QST, which was not free by any means, but basically it's a member benefit. So we've kind of on trust added programs and saying at this point, look, we've got a lot on our plate now. We are doing this. We really need your help.
All right. We have used up about all the time I feel comfortable hanging mm-hmm. on to you guys. Mm-hmm. But I do want to ask, and I wanted to talk about the league structure and your experience as a director, stuff like that.
Let me mention just some quick personal things about it. My original spot was as a section manager from 2003 to 2010. I became a vice director in 2010. I was won an election for that, and that lasted until January at the time that Dennis Bodson retired. I was very happy about that because he did feel that he had the confidence in me to be able to handle the director privileges. And as I was trying to put together a resume for him, I just realized what a great man he was. This resume was a person that showed a giant in his own profession, a very quiet, non-assuming guy, and I was just absolutely amazed. I'm happy to say that he was made an honorary vice president at that meeting.
Yeah.
But more to your question, it's very difficult being a section manager and dropping down to vice director because you have no privileges, no responsibility, and no authority whatsoever.
Just a title.
So it's very hard to go
Well, you have a responsibility. You're supposed to keep breathing.
Yeah.
So when the director keels over, you can
like
move
Bill
into
is in
their
the background
spot.
There. Bill is our vice director. I think he's in the background of the shot, maybe.
But the idea is it's difficult to go from a very active management position and get into a completely non-management position. But
the vice directors get hauled to every board meeting?
They do. They do. There was a question at one time, but that was before my tenure. And fortunately, since there have been board meetings since 2010, I've been at all of them. And the nice thing is I'm happy to be into an active management role again. And I like being here. As I say to my local clubs, I had a situation where I had to sit in for Director Bodson prior to his leaving, and I'll say, I'm not kidding you, it felt good.
So with great power comes
great responsibility,
great
but
power,
great
Director
enjoyment.
Of ARRL, President of ARRL, great power?
No.
Great responsibility?
Yes, there is that. My job in the board meeting is to keep things moving along according to Robert's Rules of Order. I don't generally take positions on motions. It's unusual for me to do that because that's why members have elected their directors whom they have confidence in. But we do have a group of 15 extraordinary people. We're voluntarily serving as directors. The directors of the ARRL don't get paid, nor do I. Or the volunteer officers don't get paid, nor do the vice directors. And we're blessed also to have 15 very talented and dedicated vice directors who assist their directors, not only during the board meetings, but also in the divisions to get things done, to visit clubs, to visit hamfests, to work as a team with their directors. So I'm a great believer, since I can't throw money at a lot of these problems because we've only got so much, I like to throw brains at them. And and having the vice directors and also the section managers across the country, having these incredibly talented and dedicated volunteers for doing what they're doing because they love amateur radio.
So people probably don't pay a lot of attention to the league structure. We members elect our section manager, who is responsible for coordinating activities within the section, but doesn't have a legislative purpose within the league. We also get to elect our directors, and they do have the legislative purpose in the league. And that's the end of our electing people. Above that, vice presidents, your job as president. Those are elected by the directors.
Yes, we are the volunteer officers and the president are elected by the directors. It is unusual, though theoretically possible, for someone to be elected a vice president or even a president who has never been a director. But that's so rare that it doesn't even bear talking about. We have had experience as directors, and so we know a little bit about what the world looks like from where they sit. And so we serve in a different capacity, but we are, you know, I went from being a director who had, oh gosh, I guess in the vicinity of about 16,000 members in the Atlantic Division back in my day, to being an officer, and I have 15 constituents. It gives a whole different complexion.
15 bullheaded constituents who are all very engaged and active in what you're doing.
Yes, so, you know, it's this is actually part of this convention is part of my farewell tour as president because I'm not seeking re-election in January. And
are we making news here? Is this headline
news?
Well,
you know, it's the worst kept secret of the war, I think. I heard about it from people at Dayton. Fortunately, it was true. I've been an elected official of the league since October of 1986, when I became section manager of Eastern Pennsylvania, and have risen up through the ranks, and now it's time to move on. But in that almost 30-year period, I've had the extraordinary opportunity to deal with, dedicated, active, committed members, other volunteer officials of the ARRL, the headquarters staff, who are amazing people. So this convention will actually probably be my last one as an elected official of the ARRL.
This one that we're at here?
This one that we're at here right now.
We're at the Shelby Hamfest, but it's also the Roanoke Division Convention.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That means a couple of extra forums. And maybe a little bit bigger booth than usual, but that's not a big deal.
No, a few more red badges, the ARRL elected officials and staff.
We're in your backyard, though.
Well, yes, I live in Blacksburg, Virginia. It's about a 3.5-hour drive from where I live. And so, coming here to this convention and what is now my home division, it's part of my farewell tour. And, seeing people and talking with folks, it reminds me a lot about why I've done this for nearly 30 years. And it's been something that I feel very grateful for, to be able to make these incredible friends and serve amateur radio.
Will there now be a mad scramble for people jockeying and elbowing to get this exalted position? Or is this one of those things where you've got the lineup of the Army grunts and said, everyone who wants to volunteer, take a step forward, and everybody takes a step back except one guy?
Well, there will be elections in January. How mad the scramble will be, I can't tell you. But at any rate, fortunately, there are people who are willing to volunteer to do this work. It is time-consuming. It's not a position, president or vice president, is not a position that one takes up lightly, because it is a big responsibility. But I'll tell you, the experience I had in the centennial QSO party last year of working thousands and thousands of ARRL members all over the world, I wouldn't trade that for anything. And so, it's been an incredible experience, and I would encourage people to step up and do some leadership stuff. Do leadership stuff in your club. Do it in the ARRL field organization, or in whatever other volunteer amateur radio capacity that you can do. And I got into this stuff nearly 30 years ago because somebody said, we need somebody to run for section manager, and I said, yeah, okay, I can do that. And here I am.
I don't think we're talking to anybody here on this show who might consider the possibility of being president. You guys may have already got it all figured out in the back rooms, the smoke-filled cloak and dagger rooms and all that stuff. It may all be decided. I don't know. But what should somebody bring to this job? And now, hour number two of Ham Radio Now at the Shelby Hamfest Roanoke Division Convention.
No, it's very quick, Gary. What you have to bring is, number one, the time to be able to do the job. Now, I don't work a day job, so considering the hours that I have put in to this, I am in absolute awe of the people who have served as ARRL president, who do have a full-time and often very demanding occupation for which they actually get paid so they can live and eat and pay the mortgage. So you have to have the time, and you have to have the dedication, and to have learned over a period of time what's involved in being a leader in a membership nonprofit organization. And different people have come to the job from different backgrounds, but basically it's having the time and the dedication to amateur radio.
Time and dedication would be prerequisites, but there's also abilities.
I would say the key word is understanding. I mean, I'm not sure exactly what it takes to be president. I can tell you that Kay's got it, and she has always had it. And I've always been in awe of what she has been able to do, how she's been able to take situations that I thought were unsolvable, and she's been able to take care of it. So have great respect for Kay. I'm really sorry to see that she's leaving the post. I know she's going to be around as a mentor, perhaps, for the next president, should they need some advice. And there's a lot of progress going on, and there are a lot of changes being made, and we're just going to have to deal with it as we've done with every other part of our lives.
Yeah. Your name in the hat?
Not even close. I want to be a director. I haven't had a chance to be one long enough.
All right, one last thing, and we'll see if we can dispose of this quickly. I know there's no way to do it justice, but as an introduction to perhaps the next time we get a chance to sit around and talk. I said the most important thing going on in ham radio right now is the Parity Act. Maybe that's not true. You mentioned bringing young people into ham radio. Maybe that's the absolute most important thing we have to do, our survival.
It's certainly very important, because if we don't ensure that there will be a next generation, we're the only ones who can do that. And different individuals can make a contribution in that way in different ways, whether it's spreading the good word about amateur radio, maybe it's teaching a class, maybe it's helping somebody who's new, who doesn't quite know how the thing is done. A lot of people get a license and never get on the air. We need to do something about that. That they're not just on paper licensees, but they're people who can actually benefit from amateur radio and then give something back to it. Yeah. So that's certainly important. Another level, of course, that of what is key for amateur radio is regulation at the international level. And that's a whole different kettle of fish that we don't remotely have time to get into. But the International Amateur Radio Union, of which the ARRL is a member, works to do advocacy for amateur radio at the international level. And we have a World Radio Communication Conference coming up in Geneva later this year. And the International Amateur Radio Union, the IARU, will have a strong presence there advocating for the interests of amateur radio, as they do at every one of these conferences. So there's a whole lot that goes on at the international level and even at the national level that we don't think about when we sit down to play radio or to build something on our workbench or to put up another antenna. But, the important thing for amateur radio is for every one of us to get involved, get active, get on the air, and help other people do the same thing.
And, and an interesting thing, I'm also on the Public Relations Committee, and a lot of the traditional advertising has been paper media and the rest. Now there's been an incredible amount in the use of Facebook and Twitter, and probably eventually Instagram. We have Sean Kutzko, who's our public relations person at ARRL headquarters. And as you mentioned, the anniversary of Hurricane Katrina, the 10-year anniversary came up. I sent him a message to say, is there any way we can bring back about the fact with amateur radio and how much role we played in Katrina? He gave me some stats on Facebook that were incredible. And it was not just the fact that he sent the stuff out, as you would in print media, but you also get likes, which means someone has touched that story. They've had that story put on their Facebook page, and the numbers were staggering. So we are looking for the younger generation. I realize Facebook no longer is younger generation. They've moved on to things like Instagram.
And yeah, mom and dad are on Facebook. Their kids don't want to be there anymore.
They
don't
want to know. I'm a grandmother, and I'm on Facebook.
So, you're not helping the cause here.
But the idea is we are trying to look for the younger demographic. And we've tried a number of things to get more youth in amateur radio. They haven't been entirely successful, but we keep trying.
Yeah,
trying.
I got a feeling that it's not one silver bullet. It's going to be a buckshot. Uh-huh. It's got to be a broad thing, and a lot of people being involved that aren't yet. But like I said, that's hour number three of Ham Radio Now. Thank you guys for sitting down with me. I really appreciate it. Kay, maybe I can get you on the show before, after you've retired from the presidency. What happens to retired politicians is they become commentators on cable news.
Or write a book.
Little spot. Well, write a tell-all book. That'll help.
I think I'll just get on the air more. How many VHF contests I have missed because there was a hamfest, there was a committee meeting, so I'll have more flexibility to get on the air and play radio more. I'm already a volunteer with Skywarn in our area, so I'll have more time to devote to that.
I'm looking for a little spot on a regular basis on some ham radio oriented YouTube show slash podcast thing. What could that possibly, what's it say on your microphone there? Oh, Ham Radio Now. That would be a good one to be on.
That's what it says. It says that right here. And if it says that, it has to be true, doesn't it?
Yeah. We'll see if I've gotten her too angry at me for doing something like that.
I can agree with Kay about getting, as a matter of fact, I think Bill Marine had made the statement to us one time. It says, how do you keep a section manager off the air? Elect him section manager.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Think about what it must be for being a president.
Well, yeah, but people said, do you have time to, and they've said this back as far as when I was section manager, do you have time to get on the air? And I said, I make time to get on the air. Because if you don't, then amateur radio turns into yet another desk job, and you turn into yet another clueless bureaucrat who really doesn't know what's going on. So, as I said before, you've got to be a radio amateur. Mm-hmm. And all of us who are involved in ARRL leadership, I think, take that to heart. And, you know, whatever makes us happy, whatever makes us feel useful and of service in amateur radio, that's what we do, and that's how we make sure that we stay in touch with the reality of amateur radio that our members are doing all the time.
Sounds like a good way to close the program. Let me make my quick pitch. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you, so if you enjoy the program, think you got anything out of it, hamradionow.tv, you'll see Arvin's little icon. He is on this side. Yeah, that side of the screen, I think. And help us out. We got that Patreon thing going, so stop by there and help out. Do you remember how we closed the program? Did I have you help close the program in Dayton?
I do not remember.
I might have done it all by myself. Do you know how the Ham Radio Now shows finish up?
Good night, Gracie.
Hmm?
Good night, Gracie.
It's not like that at all. No.
Good night, Chet.
Gracie.
That's really close. There's some bad radio procedure, and I periodically get email from someone that hears me do this at the end of a show, which means they're the one person that made it to the end of the show. Because I see the YouTube views, I see the graph that you know, the last minute or so just goes down to nothing when I'm doing the pitch for hamradionow.tv and stuff. Bad radio procedures come from Dick Tracy. 6-2 and even, over and
over
out.
And, out.
And that's how I end the program. I did that once on Ham Nation when I was helping do that. And then I got email immediately complaining about it. So, of course, now I do it all the time because it's the kind of guy I am. So I'm going to let you guys help me out. We'll do a round of introductions, and then one of you gets to say over, and one of you, I'm assigning positions, one of you gets to say over, one of you gets to say and out. Starts this way. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ.
I'm Kay Craigie, N3KN.
I'm Jim, N2ZZ. Over.
And out.
I got them to do bad radio procedure. It's awesome.